sportsmanship to me is enjoying the game and accepting any outcome as like a good outcome. Even if you lose, you learn from the game.
Sportsmanship is like based on respect. Respect your opponent.
Never underestimate them in game, even when you think that you are much better than them.
When you pretty much friends with everyone, in same time they're your opponent, and you have to understand that and be like respectful to everyone.
I guess it's more about the attitude you have.
You should take care of what you're saying, of what you're doing.
Never get arrogant when you win, and never blame others when you lose.
Standing up after you lost.
Shaking hands after a game, like look each other in the eye and just say good game.
Someone could work 5 hours more per day and I could still be better than this guy, but I know that he's putting so much heart and work to do something and I have to respect him. And for me it's a sportsmanship.
Welcome back everyone, it's time for our third game of the day as the bottom placed Millennium try once again to get some much needed points on the board against Fnatic. Now Fnatic come into the head-to-head with a 2-1 series lead and are fighting to move further on up the ladder. But for Millennium, it's really more about crawling away from the last place than head-to-head records. If Millennium lose here and the Copenhagen Wolves win their next match, there is then no way for Millennium to avoid possible relegation.
It is a difficult position to be in, and with so much pressure on Millennium to win this game, and knowing that their LCS playoff future is actually not 100% in their hands, they need to set their sights on the challenger teams that they are likely to face off against. Teams like Ninjas in Pyjamas, who will actually be playing here on our stage after the LCS games today for the second Challenger Series final.
And yesterday, Millennium's problems, well, they continued as they lost to the Copenhagen Wolves. However, to be fair, it was their first LCS game with Cotton X. And in general, Millennium actually looked pretty good during the lane phase.
Yeah, I completely agree, and I think you are right. Millennium started very well. They secured first blood for themselves, and in general, they kept up as far as global gold was concerned. Because for every tower that they lost to the Wolves, Millennium managed to secure a dragon to keep themselves even. They were not falling too far behind in CS. And the problem was that with losing those towers early on, they lost map pressure and presence, and then their team fights just felt somewhat desperate in the mid-game. They were trying to force moments where they didn't need to. The Wolves were able to control Millennium, and after some poor choices to engage in the Wolves at Baron, Millennium ended up losing the game.
And Fnatic kicked off Week 10 with a very strong win against the Super Hot Crew yesterday and never really looked like they felt challenged, really. Their strong map play and rotations allowed them to assert dominance, and they practically ignored the Super Hot Crew's champions entirely in that game.
Yeah, they really did. And, you know, Fnatic, they made it very, very clear regarding their game plan. They didn't want to have LeBlanc up against Gragas early on, and they kept lane swapping. And they also didn't want to find or force big team fights. They rotated well around the map and placed incredibly effective wards deep in Super Hot Crew's jungle. Those wards allowed them to get onto towers and take them out very quickly. We've seen Cyanide pick up Elise. It was the first time we've seen it on 4.4. He had a great game. He had early ganks, well-timed cocoons. He had a very strong presence, which is part of the reason his lanes were able to get ahead. And I have to highlight Reckless. He returned to Jinx. It was the fifth time that he had played her. It was the fifth win that he picked up with her, and he went 5-1-7. Going into yesterday's game, he had a 27 KDA, and I believe right now it's sitting at 34, thanks to those incredible stats.
Pretty sick stuff. But for now, let's check out these starting lineups for our two teams. On the blue side this time around, it is Fnatic, with Soaz in the top lane, Cyanide in the jungle, Xpeke in the mid lane, and the duo of Reckless and Yellowstar.
And on the red side, for the last time against Fnatic, it will be Kevin, Cotton X, Kerp, Creighton, and Jay Reed.
So moving to champion select then, what are we expecting from these two teams? You just mentioned that Jinx right now for Reckless is pretty formidable, but is it something that they'll focus on?
I don't think so. I think when you look at both of these AD carries, Creighton and Reckless, Creighton is the one that is arguably more susceptible to being banned out. His strongest champion by a long margin is Lucian. He doesn't tend to have the same game impacting plays when he's on a different champion. What we are seeing, though, is a favorite for LeBlanc. Once again, Kerp really likes to get his hands on that one. I think Kevin is probably somebody that we need to keep our eyes on. He's been playing a lot of Shen recently. Hasn't been playing the meta champs as often or as frequently. And I feel like a player as good as Kevin, if he gets his hands on something a bit more playmaky, maybe the games could go a little bit more in favor of Millennium.
Well, we'll see what Millennium have worked on overnight. And as we said, it wasn't all bad for them yesterday. Early game was pretty good for them. And we see, as the bans come quickly in here, that the first one out for Fnatic was Zings.
Yeah,
in straight a curve.
I also think Thresh must be a consideration here. Jayree's been playing it a lot to mixed success. He's had moments that were very, very good and moments that were not necessarily as inspiring. And we'll see what he decides to pick up as a support role, but super heavy mid lane focus this game.
Ryze taken away, Lulu taken away, Gragas taken away as well. Are they going to keep that focus in there? Let's not forget LeBlanc still open in this matchup. Millennium, well, they played Ziggs yesterday against the Copenhagen Wolves. They've gone for the likes of Gragas. Nidalee is another one that's appeared for them, but LeBlanc will be the final ban here by Fnatic, and Kha'Zix the last one for Millennium.
So they're removing the jungler away from Cyanide. Cyanide played Kha'Zix last week. Okay, he didn't necessarily have the strongest of engages, and it's something that I think the European teams are starting to learn to play. Kha'Zix is not super easy to play with and around. With Nidalee still up and available and knowing that Pekka has played it in the past, it is a potential pick. I don't think it's going to be first picked. You could see Elise. I mean, Elise is up. Cyanide ran it yesterday, had a very good game on it. It would be a safe pick at this moment in time.
I see there's quite a lot of discussion going on there among these Fnatic players as to what they're going to go for first. And they hover over Karma, a champion which they did play yesterday against the Super Hot Crew. Obviously, that was Yellow Starring. Champion, which funnily enough, we've seen Soaz himself running last split in that top lane. That is going to be locked in. Now, for Millennium, Heimerdinger is actually a consideration here.
It was banned against them yesterday. So in their game yesterday, Copenhagen Wolves banned it as their second ban following LeBlanc. I don't know if they're gonna run it. It'll be very interesting if they do. It is 4.4, so those turrets, they hit incredibly hard and they've got a lot of resistances. The one thing, okay, I'm not gonna talk about until it gets locked in. What Fnatic have done by locking in Karma, they've denied it from Jayree, and we've seen just how effective it was in the previous game by Mixer. Didn't have the most impressive of laning phases, but once we got to the mid to late game, that mobility and that single target route allowed the Super Hot Crew to find kills and single people out.
Well, in the end, they changed away from Heimerdinger and to Renekton for Kevin in this top lane. A champion which, well, every single top laner does in fact play. Although, you have to say that Kevin is one of the players that plays, I think, the least Renekton out of all top laners.
So, as a side note, the Lucian pick in the first rotation is now the third time it's happened today. All three games has been a first pick on this on red side. This is also a mirror of what Gambit did in the previous round, with Lucian and Renekton instantly locked in. You are 100% right, we don't see Kevin playing it as often as the other top laners, but it does allow Kevin some measure of safety, knowing he can win that laning phase as long as he performs well on that Renekton.
And keeps it away from Soaz, who has had some great performances with that one. But the other champion that he's done well on as well is Shyvana recently. Won games with that against the Copenhagen Wolves and against Rokkat as well, where he only died once over the two games and picked up 21 assists overall. Over for Millennium though now. We should actually touch on Fnatic's other pick here. Elise, we mentioned that earlier on. Cyanide did great with it yesterday.
So we've seen one ban yesterday and it was one pick, two games. It just went through untouched. Today, it has been untouched in our first two games of the day. Cyanide is one of the few players who does still value the champion. And like we were saying yesterday, on the patch, it's really her clear speeds. The max damage to monsters that took the biggest hit. Her stun is slightly lower, and yes, her execute is slightly lower on champions as well. But I feel like it was a jungle presence that was hit more. And it was shown yesterday because Cyanide roamed, he got multiple kills, he landed very good cocoons. On the assumption that he does the same today, it's going to help against mobile champions like Evelynn and Renekton.
Fnatic to finish off their lineup here with an AD carry and a mid laner. That would be a scary quick lineup if they went in with this one, with Shyvana running terror around the team, with Karma in there, with Sivir as well. But is that something that Fnatic feel like going for in this one? Reckless just switching through a few different AD carries.
I think he's got a lot of options available to him, and I would actually like to see the Nidalee coming out here from Pekka. It's a fairly safe laning champion, has a little bit of difficulty wave clearing in the early stages, but those heavy wave pushing farming champions are out of the been banned out. Orianna is still up, which is something that Pekka has defaulted to many times in the past. Alternatively, if they're going to go the full damage route. So Zed has been locked in. We've seen Froggen playing it earlier today. Peck is going to be running it now. With all of the mobility of the Shyvana, Sivir, and Karma, it's going to allow Zed a lot of time in those mid-game team fights to find the right target, to reposition, thanks to that immense mobility. What it also means is if Kerp is even thinking about putting Heimerdinger in the mid lane, one of the biggest things that counters a Heimer is mobility and dive ability. Elise can jump on him, Sivir can run at him, Zed can jump on him, Shyvana can jump on him. I think Fnatic could pick very smart if Millennium are even considering this champion, but I really doubt it.
I don't think so here as well. We've seen Jerry picking up interesting choices and hovering over them in multiple games this season. But what will Jerry go for here against Xpeke Zed in the mid lane? And another first time for Zed, actually. We've not seen Peke run him, as if we hadn't seen Froggen run him, but did well earlier.
Kerp's one of the few mid laners that still runs Fizz and has done it at competitive levels, has done it in recent weeks. If you wanted to run the Assassin into the Assassin, instead, he is going to lock in Xerath, and this is going to be our first Xerath. It has been available since IEM, which was 3 weeks ago.
Yeah.
Very long range, very, very good siege power. But I'm a little concerned because it's going to share the same weaknesses that a Heimerdinger faces, in that you've got a very mobile, dive-heavy team from Fnatic. So the moment Kerp plants his feet on the floor to channel that ultimate, he's just going to get swarmed and mobbed by the members of Fnatic. So there's a lot of pressure on Cotnex to get him ahead. And as long as Kerp can poke Peke down early, he's going to be able to at least outrange Peke. But the moment Peke goes in, he can just use those shadows to dodge all of the damage that Kerp is putting out.
Very excited to see how Kerp does with this Xerath in here. Other than that, Peke, we have to say we need to keep an eye on him as well, because we've not seen him bring Zed to the table so far this season. So a very big day of firsts today.
Yeah, we'll see how he performs in it. I think the composition he's coming into is also going to limit some of his targets. You know, Evelynn's going to be able to put that shield down. Lucian is going to be quite mobile. Leona is not going to pop. So we'll see if he can find the right person to blow up in those fights.
Well, you guys have been voting on which teams you think are going to win today. So let's check in and see how this match adds up. With a whopping 91% of the vote, Fnatic leads Millennium. Let's not forget, 89% of you were wrong in our last match.
You stole my line. That is exactly what I was going to say. Public opinion was with Gambit against Superhot Crew, and Superhot Crew, they bucked the trend. They proved that, you know, the underdog can still pick up wins. Considering that Millennium are so far down, we touched on it at the beginning of the game. I want to remind everybody, if Millennium win this game, let me put it that way, if Millennium lose this game and the Wolves beat Rocket, there is no way for Millennium to make it into playoffs. They have to win this game, and they obviously need Wolves to lose their game. So we'll have to see how that plays out.
Making it into playoffs is one thing, and avoiding a possible relegation is another. We're going to be finding out here if Millennium can do it as we jump in game for their matchup against Fnatic, a big mobile team. We're seeing Peke run that Zed for the first time in the mid lane. Mid lane continues to surprise us. Xerath here for Kerp as well.
Yeah, we'll see how Kerp performs on this Xerath. It has been changed. Like we said, it was changed in 4.3 if memory serves. So it's about two patches ago, one or two. Long story short, his ultimate from old Xerath is now on the W, and Xerath received a new ultimate, which is an incredibly long range. I believe it's 2,500 units at rank one. He gets three volleys off, and it is fairly difficult to land, especially against a very mobile team. You've got all these movement speed increases from Fnatic, so Kerp, he has to be so on point with landing those volleys and landing that damage.
I also wish our camera guys the best of luck keeping track of those Xerath ultimate charges as well. They'll have to be on fine form today. In terms of this early start, though, we see 1 minute in, a typical line defense. Millennium are a team, though, that even when level one invades and funky moves at level one, when they weren't in, they were still doing it every now and then.
Yeah, and I think the problem was it never worked.
True.
There was so few times that Millennium actually gained anything from those early level invades that they may just be playing a little more defensive. You've also got to remember, with a new jungler in the form of Cotnex, it's going to change that decision making. It's the jungler that is one of the hardest impacted in these early game invades, because it's his buffs, it's his camps that generally get stolen or taken away. And as it stands, it is a defensive start. It doesn't look to be any sort of late invade from either of these teams. And the only big difference is that Jerry on that Leona, on the melee, has gone for the Relic Shield as his first item.
And a standard start for the junglers as well. Cotton X getting the help of Kevin to do the red buff and a bit of help for Cyanide. Bysoas on the top side of the map as he starts off his blue buff. This bottom lane then, interested to see how this one all works out. We've had a little bit of criticism for Jerry recently with specifically his Thresh in the last 2 weeks. He's struggled to land those hooks and the flays and really just to have an impactful performance, and right now they're being zoned out completely by Yellowstar.
Yeah, to answer your question of how this lane's going to go, it's going to go terribly for Millennium. At this point in time, the immense range of Sivir and Karma is just going to poke down Lucian and Leona. They're going to need either the help of Cotton X for an early gank. He has his red buff, he's going for blue buff, so there's the possibility of moving bottom lane. Or they have to just delay, lose CS until they hit level 6, and then go all in. And that's the mobility I was talking about from Peke. He manages to dodge the Arcano Pulse by using his Living Shadow.
A very micro-intensive match this is, though, for X-Peke. Probably going to be exhausted after this one, avoiding as much as he can. But look at the damage coming in again onto Kreaton there, right at the back. Cotton X is, though, now moving in there. He's going to be stealth up as well. Fnatic there at the midpoint in the lane. And as soon as they see Millennium starting to step forward, it's going to open their eyes to the fact that there is going to be an Evelynn there. And here we go, coming in. Zenith Blade did miss. They turn it around. Cotton X gets out of the range of the tether. And Fnatic avoid the first gank of the game.
Jayree needed to hit that CC. He was level 2. He had the Zenith. He had the Shield of Daybreak. So there was a root and a stun in place. Unfortunately, he did not connect. We do see Kerp. He's got 2 points in that Arcana Pulse. He still hasn't put a point in his E, which is the stun. Now, the stun is a little bit different to the way it used to work on Xerath. He used to land his E, and then he would need to follow it up with another magic spell to stun his target. This time around, it is a skill shot. The further it travels, the longer the stun, from 0.75 seconds to 2 seconds. And if Kerp is on point, he can potentially interrupt Peke running at him. So we'll have to see if he can land that, I believe it's the Eye of Destruction.
And Peke still managing to poke nicely back as well. He's running through a few of those pots. Meanwhile, Jayree and Kreaton have had a bit more time to push further away from their turret in this bottom lane. If you take that Relic Shield into account, actually a little bit ahead in CS.
So yeah, at this point in time, Kreaton is doing okay. And I think that little bit of early presence from Cotton X is going to add some doubt to Reckless and Yellowstar's mind. They can't afford to push too deeply. And we did see Cyanide yesterday when he had his red buff in the early levels, managed to get, I think, 2 or 3 kills for Fnatic before the 10-minute mark. And it's what he's trying to rinse and repeat. There's a lot of damage in all of his lanes. He just needs to get in range, land a good cocoon, and follow it up.
And Renekton versus Shyvana here in the top lane. No surprises that Kevin has the upper hand in these early points of the game. And he's keeping Soaz away from those minions that have dropped low at the back of things and denying him from as much farm as is possible. Soaz, though, not scared to go out at this range, but we know that Kevin's going to have the upper hand on him, especially if Cotton X gets involved.
What I'd like to see from Cotton X is showing his presence in the top and the mid lane in the not too distant future. At this point in time, Peke is getting closer to having his death mark available. And if Cotton X is able to apply some pressure and put the seed of doubt in Peke's mind that Cotton X could be there, he could be moving in for a gank, that is going to allow Kerp just a little bit of breathing room. It's one of the best things about Evelynn in a straight head-to-head matchup. The team that is fighting against Evelynn never knows where she is. You can see Cotton X fairly close by, so Peke, I'm not expecting him to tower dive, but he is quite extended up that lane using his shadows to farm, doing a good job, but it is a risky place to be if Evelynn comes in from behind.
And went a fairly aggressive start if we look down his starting items at that long sword. So obviously wanting to bully Kerp out of things there. He currently has a 10 CS lead. That bottom lane once again pushed up here by Fnatic. The poke coming out of Reckless and Yellowstar causing a few issues for Jayree and Kreaton. And the issues might not stop just there. We have Cyanide sneaking up through the bush.
Yeah, we'll see. Once again, it just needs to land the CC. Unfortunately, the wave is too far pushed, so there's no real kill potential here for Fnatic against Millennium. And in terms of this early game, Fnatic have just got this slightly stronger duo lane, so they're winning it fairly, you know, easily and obviously. They're going to get a lot of damage down onto this tower, and Cotton X, he's waiting in the wings. I mean, if he's trying to counter gank a tower dive, I don't think Fnatic are interested in the tower dive at all. They just want the objective.
We are going to see the Zeni played land here onto Yellow Star, but honestly, what are they going to do? They turn around with the tether. Damage coming onto Jerry. Not enough to get the kill. Cotton X moves out. The cocoon will stop him in his tracks, and a bit of back and forth. The support's taking the brunt of the damage.
There wasn't enough mana for Rekkles and Yellow Star to really continue that engage. We do see Rekkles is backing away. Jerry still has Ignite, toying with the idea of going in, but needs to be so scared. With Cyanide backed away and knowing Yellow Star is not there, there was some kill potential, but you could see Fnatic didn't really want that engage. Now, it's all of a sudden Fnatic needs to defend the onslaught of Millennium. They've got three members in the lane, and we'll see how much damage they can get in the tower. It's going to be much more difficult with two melee champions.
Good poke landed there onto Jerry, though, and we heard the low health ping coming in. He's going to have to just recall away. Mid lane. We actually saw Peke recalling, finishing off his Brutalizer, picking up the Boots of Speed and the Null Magic Mantle as well. So Kerb's going to have a little bit of a tougher time. He himself, though, has picked up that Seeker's Arm Guard for a bit more damage. More importantly, I think, at this stage, that extra armor.
Yeah, and something we did, it wasn't on camera, but you can see the cooldown of Rite of the Arcane, which is Xerath's ultimate. It was actually used just to farm up that wave a little while ago. So using it to keep back, you can see Kerb is playing it very safe against Peke. He doesn't want to be in a position where he gets jumped on and killed. He's already 10 CS down. Talking about the CS numbers, I think Kreaton, along with the help of Jairi, is doing very well. On patch 4.4, the Relic Shield CS that is shared is also added to the CS total for the AD carry. So they're actually sitting even right now, 58 to 57, despite Kreaton having a little bit of extra gold from his GP10.
I did forget about that one. You are right. Cotton X here, though, is waiting on the top side of the map. Red buff is on him, so as not really moving past the corner there of that river. That's almost his safe spot, how far he dares really move out, not knowing. As Peke dashes forward, actually going to get stunned up here. That means a good bit of damage from Kerb, but Peke doesn't seem two-faced.
Yeah, that was the stun that we were talking about. It is a skill shot. It travels quite slowly, in fact. But as Living Shadow was down, Peke had no tools to dodge it, with the exception of maybe flashing or using that death mark. And because you don't know where Evelynn is, Peke is getting some good wards. He's just placed, there's a pink there, in the river. So if Cotton X comes from the sort of dragon side of the river towards mid lane, Peke is going to get vision on it.
Kind of like getting run over by a bus. It comes a lot slower, but when it does hit you, it's going to hurt straight away afterwards. Blue buffs are coming up here. Kerb moving across the side, and that's going to give Peke a little bit of time to have a go on Kerb's tower and actually doing decent damage. Is Jerry getting caught here at the bottom? Yellow Star steps forward. The poke is good. Can they finish off? Rekkles is going to pop his ultimate as well. Kreaton gets off behind the tower. Oh, but has he gone too deep? Here comes Evelynn from the side. Puts down Agony's Embrace, but it didn't really do a lot.
No, it throws down the Agony's Embrace, does not continue the chase. Jerry landed a very good Zenith Blade there, decided not to use his Ignite. Fnatic burned a lot of ultimates on that little trade, and it's going to allow them to take this tower down uncontested, especially because Cyanide has been seen, and I'm not expecting Millennium to stick around. They have backed away. Fnatic, early advantage, they take the first objective. They may even be able to go for Dragon as well, because they know they forced that Leona and Lucian back.
One big praise point we had for Fnatic yesterday was how quickly they were at seizing opportunities, pushing as a three, rotating all the men around, and just generally being on the point when it came to calls and timings. They've done it here again. Perfect time to move down towards that bottom lane, take the tower, but there might be in a little danger here around Dragon. Jerry's actually going to go deep onto Cyanide. He's going to get leashed up with the rest of Millennium chasing in. They've not got the speed to catch up, but they've stopped the Dragon.
More importantly, Millennium have the potential to force Fnatic away. They need to be a little bit careful, though. If Kerb was to set up like a siege position, he could get some good damage and some good zoning. Instead, he needs to come back and defend this mid tower. Holds onto it, and now all of a sudden, Jerry's in trouble.
Jerry is caught miles out of things here, and actually Cyanide is just going in there solo on team. Rekkles joins in, and that is first blood. That can't happen. Cyanide getting a lot of damage back. There is the repel coming in. In comes the ultimate actually out of Kerb, but they couldn't get the last blast off. Cyanide comes down just behind it. Cyanide lives after getting the kill.
Yeah, the repel managing to save his life. Kerb held onto that final charge of his ultimate, didn't manage to connect with Cyanide, and That's the first one that we've seen. The amount, the range is still very good, but it is so, so difficult to land, especially against this particular composition from Fnatic. So they hold on to now a 2,000 gold lead. They have a CS advantage for their AD carry, as well as their mid laner. And the top lane, I mean, Soaz, he's in a losing matchup. He's only 10 CS down, and you've got to remember he's got teleport as well. So the moment these bigger fights and objectives start to be battled for, Soaz can join at a moment's notice.
And Soaz, you have to say he's played this one perfectly as well, knowing that Cortanex is the only real threat to him. Realistically, Kevin shouldn't be able to kill him in that lane one-on-one. He's not gone past the river point. He's not gone out to a position where Cortanex could really get involved with things. And as you mentioned, even with that, even with sticking back for a good amount of time, now, I mean, he's starting to get stronger and stronger at level 9. He got the workings of that Sunfire Cape. Now he can afford to push out a little bit more, and he stays very, very even on CS. And as we see now, Fnatic coming back towards his bottom lane. JRE going to get caught up in this one. They have to back out.
Yeah, there's so many minions. Reckless didn't really want to pick a fight with 2.5 champions effectively. All of those minions smacking away take off a lot of damage. So Reckless clears the wave out, is going to force Millennium backwards. The reason JRE had to run so quickly is they had no tower to fall back on. Got a lot of damage, and we'll have to see if Millennium can get in here. Good solar flare could be disruptive, but they're not even going to challenge. This is an uncontested dragon for Fnatic.
Second objective of the game, and a close to 3,000 gold lead for Fnatic with just 12 and a half minutes on the clock. And there are the pings towards Soaz in the top lane. They know that Evelynn was around there. Soaz knows that he has to watch out a little bit.
This is going to be a difficult dive if they want to go for it. You've got Dragon's Descent, you've got Flash on Soaz, and Burnout. So, you know, Cortanex is feeling a little bit brave. If he lands everything perfectly, and if Kevin can chase with Slice and Dice, yeah, maybe they can make it happen. But I'm not a believer right now. I think it's going to be difficult. So we'll see how long Cortanex hangs around. Got a ward on that blue buff. The next time Pekka goes for that blue, he's going to challenge, and here's the dive. Once again, has to follow Soaz. There's Soaz away.
Soaz going to the top side here. Who is tanking it up? That will be Kevin. Cortanex actually going to take on that one. He's taking a lot of damage. Soaz flashes away. Here comes Cyanide around the backside. There are minions there, so Cortanex will be able to get out of this one, but Cyanide follows in. Has he got the damage to finish up? He could probably have both of them, you know. The Spiderling goes in. The damage is turned around. Cortanex goes down, but Cyanide dies to Kevin. Yeah, Soaz is coming straight back in. Kevin flashes away. Soaz used it earlier and can't continue through.
It is going to allow Soaz to push the wave down, reset that freezing that he had hold on, and get some damage onto that top tower. They end up trading one for one. Cyanide not having enough damage to get both of the kills because he'd used his cocoon earlier to try and save Soaz. Soaz gets away with his life early on, and now he's going to get a lot of damage onto this turret.
Rotation from the duo lane from Fnatic straight up to that top lane. That's where the objective is open for them, and again, they do it perfectly here. They're not going to be able to stop this one from happening. That turret is going to form. We can see that Kevin's hanging back a little bit in his lane. Millennium trying on mid, though.
Creatine's going to be in a little bit of trouble. If you look in the river, Peke is trying to get in range, but he walked across a ward. So Creatine and JRE were backing away. And in that situation, you could actually see Cyanide getting closer and closer to the objective. Unfortunately, no tower secured yet for Millennium, and they find themselves a big amount of gold down. Soaz is going to get caught out. He's got Dragon's Descent. We'll see if he can get away.
Oh, actually turns the damage back onto Kevin. Doesn't even need to use that ultimate. Just strides on off. Got a Vamp Scepter now at this point as well. We've just seen Kerb doing his own red buff, because frankly, the rest of his team were nowhere near to give him any help. Creatine and JRE being kept busy in this mid lane. JRE again goes for that Zenith Blade onto Reckless.
What I like about Kerb's build, he rushed an Hourglass, so it means he's less likely to be jumped on by Peke. So that's good. And look at the damage that Arcano Pulse is already doing. Can the Rites of Arcane do anything? That's one. That's two. That's not enough.
Well, all three landed, but not the damage there. Sonya's Hourglass was the first item, now complete here for JRE. That's going to give him a bit more safety, specifically when it comes to ex-Peke and the death mark that Peke can throw onto him if he decides to go all in.
Yeah, so with the blue buff, as well as the base cooldown on that Arcane, Rite of Arcane from Xerath, it's a minute and a half cooldown. It's not the longest of cooldowns, and that's going to get shorter at level 16, and even more so when Kerb eventually picks up some cooldown reduction. I am expecting him to do that, because that is all of the power of Xerath. He needs to be throwing out those Arcano Pulses and getting down those Ws, those Eyes of Destruction, as often as possible. One of the biggest differences from old Xerath to this one as well, you can now move while channeling your Q. Trying again on Soaz, no flash, and I don't think they're going to run him down.
No.
it's an uninspiring gank, but that's the power of Shyvana. Burnout for movement speed, Dragon's Ascent for gap closer. You have to land everything so perfectly to kill her.
And especially when the CC from Renekton and Evelynn, despite, you know, the stun out of Renekton, is not really much more after that one, especially when Cortanex doesn't want to use his ultimate for that. We see Kerf there just clearing out that wave once again. Peke maintains a 30 CS lead over him, though, in this mid lane. Blade of the Ruined King is now added in to that Brutalizer from earlier on. Let's look at the AD carries there as well for a little while. 142 to 124. Reckless still having the lead. Both of them at this point do have Bloodthirsters though.
Yeah, the global gold is obviously putting Reckless further ahead, hence getting closer to most likely a Zeal or something similar. We're going to see another Siege potential. Solar Flare is available for Jerry. Can he connect?
Oh, they're throwing everything on towards Cyanide here, but he can just walk out of ulti range there of Kerp. Yellow Star going to tank the turret up a little bit, and we see that Kerp not doing enough damage here at all.
And even worse than that, Jerry missed another, you know, set of CC. That Solar Flare was not effective enough. Had the Solar Flare caught members of Fnatic, it would have allowed Kerp to just get all of that damage down, but it didn't happen. And you know, Jerry's having a torrid time right now. The Millennium is behind in a composition that they want to be forcing fights, they want to be sieging. You know, Zera's going to be a decent counter gauge, but here comes Soez from the side.
Soez from the side, that pulls all three of them away. Kevin is coming in as well, and he'll get the stun off there, do a little bit of damage, but Soez will really see. They just walk out. Fnatic pick up the third and final outer turret of this game. And look at the gold, approaching 4,000 with Dragon up in less than a minute.
One of the biggest things that Fnatic has an advantage in terms of their team composition right now. Oh, Jerry's going to get rooted and maybe killed.
Oh, he's actually gone in there. He's gone very deep on this one. He will go down though. Kreaton will pick a kill back up, but Cyanide dives in. Barrier used here by Kreaton, but the kill will happen. Oh, will it? No, they've managed to keep him alive. Somehow he survives through. The Bloodthirster giving him all that lifesteal back, and now Reckless being pushed away from mid.
Yeah, you were expecting 4.3 elise damage. This was 4.4 elise damage, and it was just not enough to get through it. But now Kotnik's going to get popped.
Oh, the death mark is onto him there. It's not enough, though. There wasn't enough follow-up damage there from XPK to make that one happen. It may be enough, though, as Soaz is going to dive in. He actually lands the E, but Kotnik's running around the other side. Yeah, he's got no idea. Doesn't have the vision of him. Kevin here is very low. Kerb coming across. Soaz feeling pretty strong and tanky from that, but no kills resulting from Fnatic. They did crucially hold on to that mid turret though.
Yeah, so no bonus damage from that Zed to actually allow Kotnix to get popped by the death mark. It means that Fnatic come away a little bit worse for wear. There are still things that Millennium can do and that can pull off, but the key for Millennium is to be in a stationary siege position where Xerath can get a lot of damage down and very importantly allow Evelynn, Renekton and Leona to be in the thick of things. If they are not in and amongst the Fnatic members holding them in place, then Fnatic are just going to disperse, find Kreaton, find Kerb and kill him.
What's going down? Dragon is live. Fnatic did take that one from earlier. Yellow Star going to speed himself up, was trying to get some poke off onto Kerb. They're going to push this mid lane out. Let's not forget that Soaz has got a teleport, so he can get involved in this fight if needs be.
So the point I was trying to make before that fight happened in mid lane is that Fnatic have got very good split pushing power with Zed as well as a teleport Shyvana. It's going to allow Fnatic to control the side lanes and control the tempo of the map very effectively. Millennium have to send either their front line or their sieging champion to deal with it, and that's not ideal for their comp. Millennium wants to be in a siege position. Now, Dragon's been started, and there's not a lot of members of Fnatic close by. Millennium has started the fight.
They're going to try and lock up Cyanide, but there we see him jump straight back up towards the Dragon. He's getting hit by Kerb's ultimate, but that's not enough. They turn around towards Yellow Star. He is actually going to have to use that Mikael's on himself to try and escape it. The Ignite is ticking. Kreaton actually finishes off there, and the rest of Millennium have forced Fnatic away. They even pick up the Dragon there right at the back, and the kills go in their way completely. Soaz and Reckless both very low. Kevin trying to chase onto him. He actually has Flash available there, but didn't want to go for it.
And that is exactly what we talked about. Millennium were able to keep Kerb in a stationary siege-based position. Fnatic were so scrambled trying to deal with members of Millennium, and they were split up. They couldn't get on the priority targets. Now, Peck is trying to get away with his life. He does have his Living Shadow available, so we'll see if he can dodge. Dodges one stun, gets caught by the other.
All being thrown in towards Peke. Now Cotonex is going to show up. Can Peke escape this one? He's still running for his life. Is he going to get away from it? Cotonex goes off to the left. It's harder to spot the Evelyn when she's running at you. Completely invisible. Jayree's running around from the back. Cotonex is going to speed himself up. Peke is going to have a shadow to run off to in just a second. Damage back onto Cotonex, who realizes actually he might be able to turn that run around onto me. And there is Peke still running into the mid brush. He goes. He does turn around. He's going to have a go at Jayree, but Cotonex gets the finish.
Good stunt from Jayree. Immediately locks Peke up. He takes everybody on a nice long run. That sequence of events was very good for Millennium. They grabbed 3 kills in total, they got a dragon as well, and they've actually evened up that goal difference between Fnatic and themselves. What Millennium also demonstrated is an ability to play to the strengths of their composition. As long as Evelynn and Renekton were running around keeping Fnatic busy, it buys time for Kreatin and Kerb to deal damage. If Fnatic are unable to have Peke come in from the side and blow up one of those priority targets, which is so much more difficult because of the Zhonya's Hourglass on Kerb, for example, it means Fnatic have to play the map game to win. It's going to be quite difficult for them to deal with that entrenched siege-based Millennium comp because of the items that have already been picked up.
In terms of items, let's have a look more down the AD carry route here. It's a big CS lead for Reckless over Kreatin. Bloodthirst, a last whisper done for Reckless. On the other side, Kreatin moving up towards that Trinity Force. Got 2 out of 3 parts of it, along with his Bloodthirster as well.
I think it's pretty standard here. Nothing super exciting. Cyanide once again going for some very early penetration. The Haunting Guys and the Sorcerer Shoes. It's also part of the reason that Cyanide's gone down so quickly. He's only got those sort of tanky stats from that Ancient Golem, which is not necessarily the greatest at this stage in the game. Cotonex is doing pretty well with that Evelynn and Peke. Does not want that fight. He does manage to get away, but that's a good position for Kevin to be in. If he's able to 1v1 Peke without his Ignite and with Dominus still available, maybe he can deal with that split push of at least one member of Fnatic.
And I think start to back away, and actually most champions just going back into more of a farming phase in this one. You saw there, Soaz and Kreatin both on the top side of the map. Kreatin, as I said, working up to the Trinity Force. His opponent there for now, at least Soaz, does have his Sunfire Cape already done and does have that Cutlass as well. But look at this, Millennium starting to move through the Fnatic jungle.
Now, Millennium need to find a way that they can siege up with good vision. Oh, they've jumped on Reckless.
Oh, Jerry's gone very deep. He's actually taken a turret hit and a lot of damage there from Cyanide. But look at the artillery from the back there, helping get the kill onto Reckless. This is surely the turret as well.
Yeah, it's definitely going to be. That was exactly what Millennium are looking for. The hard CC from Leona or Renekton. It's not over yet. Now Kevin's in trouble.
Kevin in trouble, but he manages to slice away from it. The rest of Fnatic do change around. There's a slow from Yellowstar. He had to flash to get it. Deathmark down onto Kevin.
I don't think
it's enough damage, but there's the dragon from the side. Kevin going low. They do get the kill. The shutdown comes in. Kerb's going to use the Zhonya's, but the fangs are going to sink down from Cyanide. He picks up another one and a nice turnaround. But Millennium are now looking for more. Cocoon lands on to Kreatin, he can't stick around.
That was a very good Mikhail's Crucible and Shield from Yellowstar. He saved Soaz's life. Soaz was eating every single bullet of the culling from Kreatin at the end of that fight. Millennium stuck around just a tiny bit too long because they didn't know where Fnatic was. They picked up the kill, and then they were trying to siege that inner turret, the outer turret in the mid lane, but unfortunately for them, Fnatic were able to respond so incredibly quickly. Soaz ran down from top lane, peeled in from behind, and was able to grab a couple kills in favor of Fnatic. So Fnatic hold on to a gold lead. Thanks to the kills they picked up, they're now in the advantage by 2,000.
Okay, going to keep split pushing this one off as well. He's down in that bottom lane. Not past the halfway mark. Reckless is making sure that mid lane's going to go through. And we'll see Soaz in the top lane. Now this 1-3-1 split going on. We can see there Kevin on your screen chasing down Xpeke. Cotonex starting to come into things as well. But Xpeke is he's gone. That's the Peke gone camera.
That is the Peke gone camera. It worked this time. It didn't work last time. He was managed. It did get caught out by Millennium. But I think what Millennium need to try to do is find a siege like they're trying to do now. They're grouping up mid, they're going on Yellow.
Yeah, and Yellow is dead, I'm afraid, for him there. That's 4 versus 1, and if you get caught out against a team like this, the burst of Kerb is pretty significant at this point. I mean, 0-1-3, yes, he's got the Zhonya's in there, he's got that Void Staff and those Sorcerer Shoes as well. He can blow up Yellow Star, yeah, that's for sure.
As long as his CC that lands. You know, that time around, Kerb was able, Jayree was able to land a good Solar Flare. He's gotten a bit more accurate as this game has moved on. And Fnatic are, they're actively avoiding grouping. Fnatic are actively avoiding meeting Millennium in a straight up 4v4, 5v5. And like we said, they're using that Shyvana and that Zed to try to control the side lanes. They are going to catch Jay Ree, decides not to use the death mark though. Once again, no vision from Fnatic. So in order for Fnatic to pick a team fight, I think they have to have absolute vision and they have to get onto Kreatin. If there's no clear direction onto Kreatin, I almost feel like Fnatic's not going to start a fight at all.
Millennium are already hanging around by Dragon. Peke's on the bottom side of it. They've got that advantage that Continex can have a bit of a scout around without being spotted if he's careful about it. And the rest of Fnatic do finally start to move in position. Peke has now shown himself over there, and we can see the charge coming in. Reckless takes the brunt of that damage. They're actually going towards Continex, who throws down Egg in his embrace. Here comes the ultimate from Kerb. It's doing good damage, or at least the first one did. Deathmark actually went on towards Continex. Will it be enough to finish him off? No, not quite. Soaz is chasing down for that one. He actually flashed in there to finish off the kill. Kreatin's trying to get behind the turret. He does so as well. Peke picked up Kerb, and that is three for nothing for Fnatic.
Millennium should never have been in that position. Kevin was nowhere near. He was still pushing up in the top lane. Fnatic realizing that they had a 5v4 position. They jumped onto Millennium. It was actually Cotnex that was caught out of position and not Kreatin. Fnatic didn't care. They just engaged, ran him down. Now with the numbers advantage, Fnatic are going to be able to destroy this Baron. We do see Kevin and Kreatin maybe coming to challenge, but they're going to have to do something monumental to pull off any sort of steal.
Telestar trying to keep Kevin out and doing a real good job with that one. Baron's down to 2,000 HP. They're going to keep going onto it. Who's going to pick it up? It's Fnatic. They get the Baron. Kevin doing great damage in there, though. He might even get himself two kills. Not quite there with Peke and Reckless bearing down. Jerry's going to get tethered up. Are they going to finish up? No, they didn't want to face check the bush.
Dead times were very short, so Fnatic playing it safe. They didn't know how close Millennium were to re-engaging on them. You can see that Cotnex and Kerb were about halfway down that middle lane. If you look at the fight, we talked about how Kevin on Renekton, Evelynn and Leona need to be running amok in the team. They only had two of those members. So right now, Fnatic just single out the targets of Millennium and there's nothing to stop them. Kevin is a mile and a half away, Soaz is able to teleport in, and truthfully, this is just a straight 5v4. Fnatic ran them down, got the kills, got the Baron. We did see in the picture-in-picture that it was Millennium that picked up that Dragon, though. So at the very least, Millennium come away with some global gold, but you can't discount the very smart, non-hesitant play from Fnatic.
And credit to Soaz once again, having a fine game here on Shyvana. Played a perfect early game against... always tricky against the Evelynn, that unseen threat. And again, he's just spotting Cotonex running up towards that top lane. Actually, Peke is just hanging in there. He was trying to split push once again. Baron buff, of course, is on Fnatic right now. So they're the ones calling the shots.
Yeah, and to exemplify the item build, Peke's actually got himself a Ghost Blade to go in there. They're going to go on Cotonex.
And I'm not sure you're escaping this one, Cotonex. A lot of damage comes his way. Actually gets away from the death mark there. Jerry giving him some good support to let him escape that scenario, but they still need to be careful here. Fnatic is still hanging around.
Yeah, the shield from their target, the face of the mountain rather, was very, very useful in helping to block some of that physical damage, but it is a slightly different build that we see on that Zed. It is going to give him some additional armor penetration when he, you know, throws down the active, and what I think is more important and relative is the mobility boost that it gives you. Against this, you know, high damage Xerath, you want to dodge his spells, and if you don't have a Living Shadow available, heck, push number two and run away from it because you're going to have that movement speed boost from the Ghost Blade.
See, Reckless does have a Phantom Dancer with his Bloodthirster and Last Whisper here, so he just heals everything back up that Kerb previously threw down onto him. So as getting himself the workings of that Randuin's Omen with the Giant's Belt and Warden's Mail. Trinide, we said before, he's now getting a little bit more tankiness to him as well after going for that early penetration.
Yeah, and it's very standard. Once you've got a little bit to work with, I think Cyanide needs to grab himself probably some magic resistance over and above that Spectral's Cowl. And the reason for that is Evelynn and Xerath are hitting very, very hard. Xerath is getting some cooldown reduction now. He's a little bit over 300 ability power with his Void Staff built in there as well. When those Arcano Blasts hit, they hurt. And we've seen him, you know, basically two and three-shotting Fnatic members when they get stunned up. So let's see how Fnatic deal with the siege. The wave clear from Millennium is all concentrated on Xerath. He is the only safe and effective wave player. So it's just going to tower dive.
Having a good time against Kevin there, just trying to force out the dominance. Meanwhile, XPeke just split pushing, as we'd expected here with this set, going straight in, and actually he's going to be diving on towards crits, and that's a lot of damage, and the death mark is enough to get that final pop. Meanwhile, Yellowstar and Reckless come around, and they finish off the tower.
Yeah, very easy kill there from Peke, just landing every single ability that he needed to. Millennium on the back foot, they trying to defend against a Baron buff Fnatic, so they don't want to pick a fight, but they also can't really contest with the split pushing. While Peke was pushing bottom lane, Soez is dealing with Kevin in the top lane completely. He's got the tower. I mean, a moment ago, he could have tower dove to get a kill, and Soez and Siobhan has now outscaled Renekton. He's got the items that he needs, the levels that he needs, that Renekton's no longer a bully to him.
And Fnatic simply turn their focus to that mid lane. Again, damage thrown down at max range by Kurt, but you've got to land that damage. Cyanide says, oh, I'm going to tank this one up. A couple of auto attacks in on that one. Three turrets on Millennium, five to Fnatic. Obviously, all outer rings are now down. Just the inner turret in the mid lane remains. And I'm not sure that Millennium can really hang around, especially once they spot Peke coming in from this one. Actually, Jiri going to dive pretty deep, throws the solar flare out. Cyanide goes back onto him. Reckless had to flash there.
Yeah, here comes Soez from the side. Peke's in trouble from Cut next.
And I don't think he's going to manage to escape this one. This could be very, very close. He does get away to the shadows, but the speed boost from Cotonix comes in once again. Can Peke get away? We've seen this scenario before. Soez coming in. Blade of the Ruined King will stop Cotonix from chasing. And Peke turns around on this one. Cotonix now finds all of a sudden that he's the one running away from the dragon. Soez continues to get that chase on. There is the shield coming in from Jiri. And the rest of the team now forced Soez to turn away. Not before he's had a bit of a laugh. And he will get away.
Millennium were chasing Fnatic back in the mid lane, and because of that, now Fnatic have got some pretty good positioning in this jungle. If Fnatic can catch somebody out, they may be able to get a kill. Good slice and dice there from Kevin, and Yellowstar just looking for poke, but this has allowed Fnatic onto the inner mid turret. They pick that one up. A lot of map play, nobody really going down in that situation, but Fnatic coming out the better because of the incredible amount of mobility from their champions.
And we've got 1 minute 20 seconds for the Baron. The Dragon comes up in a minute. Millennium did take that last one. Surprisingly enough, Peke is just going to go straight back to that bottom lane and continue his split push. This was last year's tactic from Fnatic. It was a tactic that so many teams couldn't even get close to stopping.
Split pushing with a teleport on one of the split pushes. It is the de facto Fnatic strategy. And it's what they did immaculately, I think. Their understanding of when to push and when to do things is great. And, you know, Soez, he's taking no damage from Kevin in that situation. And even with Cotonex nearby, they didn't contest it. Cotonex is still sticking around. Creatine's even in this top lane. And Soez is just running interference. The longer he stays here, the deeper Peke gets to push that lane in the bottom wave. So it may look like Soez is playing quite bravely against three members, but it's buying Peke and Fnatic time to get control of that bottom half of the map.
Few buffs being picked up, red buff for both sides. Soez continues to push. Peke has come back from his trip in the bottom lane and will be soloing that dragon that I said was coming up in a minute's time. 10 seconds though now to Baron. Yellowstar's already in position with pink wards. He's going to ward down the back as well. Fnatic have full vision control of the pit.
And because of the map presence they've got, thanks to the four sweeping lenses, Fnatic right now can dictate the pace of this game. They're onto the most difficult towers to get, the inhibitor turrets. And because they have the ability to tower dive, but it's very risky against Evelyn and a Leona, and because it's quite hard to get to that Xerath, Solar Flare didn't connect, but that was a flash from Yellowstar at least, so cooldown for cooldown, advantage Millennium. Fnatic have to pull Millennium towards them, get kills, and then go for an inhibitor turret. I kind of feel like even with a 10k gold lead, there is still a lot of damage and wave clear from Curb that could make Fnatic's life difficult.
And Soez just continues to run rings around them in the jungle, even with that sweeping lens on and clearing things out. And Fnatic, they knew, I mean, Yellowstar went in, took the pink ward. He had complete vision of both sides there of the entry. He knew how safe he was. They did get another ward in the back, but I'm not sure that they're going to be able to stop this one off. Kerb, I think, is going to have to be the hero. Jerry is going to fall. The death mark will be enough to finish him off. Peke going in towards Karnex. Peke flashes away, dodges all the charges there of Kerb's ultimate, and now they chase through. The Baron was picked up in the meantime. Kevin is going to fall down, gets caught here in the cocoon. Cyanide gets that one. That's two men down. Baron to Fnatic.
That was a 2v4 that Fnatic came out ahead of. Peke jumped onto Leona with his ultimate, and we've seen Soez just running interference there against the members of Millennium. With the kills and the Baron in favor of Fnatic, they are now on the inhibitor turret. They're going to get the turret, and they're going to get the tower. If Kerb sticks around, he could get taken out.
Well, Soez did step forward there, thinking he might be able to have a go, and there is a cocoon landing. So that might have enough damage, and actually he will. It's Reckless that gets it in the end. Cyanide just rappelling away. Soez did live, by the way, in case you were just wondering from that one. The tanky dragon not having many problems, and look at this. Yellow Star pushes mid, perfect timing.
As long as Fnatic have a numbers advantage, they are in a better position. They've got an immense gold lead as well. You can't discount that, plus Baron, so it would have taken a perfect defense for Millennium to even hold those objectives. But Fnatic, they find the picks, they find the kills, they find the objectives, and they've just played this game really, really intelligently as it has progressed.
And Fnatic gonna go home and spend the gold, which I do believe they should have a lot of. Yeah, there we go. 2,700 in the top lane. In fact, 4 out of 5 have over 2,000. Peke had already been back just earlier on. Picked himself up a Sword of the Divine. So other purchases coming in. Blade of the Ruined King for Reckless on Sivir. Guardian Angel now for Cyanide to lease. Aegis for Karma. Thorn Mail for Soez, as if you couldn't kill him before.
There is so much damage across all of the members of Fnatic that it is just a matter of time before they get that damage onto the targets. Thanks to Peke having the Sword of the Divine for 100% critical hit chance, if he combines that with his Death Mark on even Renekton, through all of that armor and the Last Whisper in Peke's back pocket, I actually think he's going to kill Kevin. He can pop him with that Death Mark thanks to that itemization. It's definitely not standard, but when you've got a 15,000 gold lead, 8 towers to 3, barons and dragons, why not? Get 2 auto attacks down that are guaranteed critical hits, and that's it. You are finished, that's a dead crocodile.
And that's moving closer in once again, that baron. Still got plenty of time, almost half in fact, still left on that one. Jerry's going to have to land everything, and they're going to have to do something about Soez, because he's run straight up the middle. All 5 Millennium men are trying to defend that inhibitor turret, and Soez just running amok here. Literally a mop right in the middle of the team. Cotton X tries to do some damage, ends up coming off worse for it. Kerb's trying to keep the rest of the 4 away in that bottom lane by blasting them away as much as possible. But Jerry taking a hell of a lot of poke. They're going to step forward at some point and go for this one. Solar Flare went in, but it landed onto Reckless. He gets away from that one. Everything's been blown now, and Fnatic turning around. Soez is right at the front of the entire team. Cotton X caught at the back. They blow up everyone at the front. Kevin should be able to get through onto the fountain, but Fnatic don't care about that. They've just taken 4 kills for nothing. The Nexus turrets go down, the Nexus itself falls, and Fnatic pick up a dominating win here against Millennium.
Flawless execution from Fnatic, executing 4 members of Millennium. Millennium tried a last-ditch effort. That fight was too little, too late. When you're 15,000 gold down, you need to land everything perfectly and kill somebody instantly if you're going to defend that inhibitor turret. Those things did not happen, so Fnatic just re-engaged, ran Millennium down, and another game from Fnatic where they controlled the map very well.
They did. They did almost exactly what we said in that pregame in terms of how well they played against the Super Hot Crew yesterday. We saw, to really get things started, the move from Cyanide as they forced the duo away from the bottom lane. They came in there, took the first turret. They moved a little bit later on towards the dragon. They did the same in the top lane, then into the mid lane, and it was just a plan that went flawlessly for Fnatic. And talking about that last fight, just looking down the health bars on my side screen here, they didn't lose any health.
No, they didn't, because they got jumped on, and then because the tower diving Soez was tanking up that turret for 3 or 4 shots, the rest of the team just ran down the members of Millennium. It was, they got killed so quickly. Sword of the Divine on Zed, running you down with Ghostblade and, you know, Armor Pen, Blade of the Ruined King. Nobody could survive. Fnatic are back to their map controlling ways, and that's good, because that was the Fnatic that went 7-0 at the start of the spring split when they played the map. And yeah, they almost ignored the champions to an extent, because it's about the objectives, it's about the Nexus. Kills help you, of course, but when you're playing towers, you can secure them that effectively. Why force a kill when you don't need to?
Back to winning ways, I think, is the real key for Fnatic here. We saw how that 8-game losing streak after winning 7 in a row was just very, very hard for them to really handle. They finally bounced back with a win over Gambit after that one, but and it was kind of win a couple, lose one, win one, lose one, but now they're on a 4-game winning streak, and to be honest, at the perfect time in the season.
What that means right now, coming into this game, SK Gaming, Gambit, and Fnatic were all tied at 13-10. Were tied. At the top of the table was Alliance at 14-10. Now, because Fnatic have picked up a win...
Let me guess, they're tied.
They are now tied. Wow. Who would have guessed? At first place with Alliance. So they're currently holding that position. For Millennium, on the other hand, they were 7-16 coming into this game. They are now 7-17. If one more team picks up a victory above them, for example, Copenhagen Wolves or Rocket, for example... Wolves today, if they win, they guarantee Millennium are into the possible relegation going into that summer promotion tournament. Even if Wolves lose and say Wolves pick up a game next week, that's it. One more victory from Wolves and that's going to knock Millennium out.
So what we're guaranteed here with 1 week left to go, considering we've got two more matches left today, the final one being the rematch of SK against Gambit, it means with 1 week to go, we've actually got a three-way tie for first place. Because either SK or Gambit are going to be 14 for 10, yeah. And Alliance and Fnatic are in that position as well. Who would have guessed it? I think we might be having a few tiebreakers at the end of the season.
As it stands right now, two teams sitting tied for first place, three teams sitting tied for that second place. We'll have to see how these games play out. And, you know, we were talking about some of the possibilities of if A beats B and B loses to C. We worked out it was close to about a million different options because... For each team having five different possibilities, yeah. And then each other team having five, it is so difficult to predict how this region is going to go. And I mean, Super Hot Crew beat Gambit. Super Hot Crew are not out of this yet. They're at 10-14. Yes, they're 4 games off the pace. But if they pick up a win against, you know, Fnatic and Alliance and, say, SK Gaming, all of a sudden they're 13-14. Each of those other teams is 14-11, maybe 14-12. So it's impossible to predict what's going to happen.
What we're saying is our stat guys are going to be very, very busy trying to work out all those eventual possibilities that we've still got in this one. For now, though, we're going to have a two-way tie at the top of the league. It's going to be three very soon, but we are going to head over to Shox and Deficio, who have Fnatic's Xpeke with them at the table.
Thank you very much, Joe. Indeed, we are joined here by Xpeke, as Fnatic is now on a 4-0 winning streak. I want to start by going back to the beginning of the game. Actually, pick some bans, because with Ziggs, Ryze, LeBlanc, Lulu, Gragas, and Kha'Zix banned out, you have to go kind of a different route. Tell me about pick some bans.
Yeah, we did. I thought they might ban Gragas or something, but Bora didn't think so. So we were like, okay, let's just ban those champions. Then LeBlanc and Gragas will be open. I can play one of those, and it's really safe, really easy. But then they ban Gragas. We end up banning a lot of mid lanes. They ban some as well, and I was like, I could play Nidalee, or but if he plays something weird, because I know he's gonna play something weird, either Heimer or Talon or Serra, like he did or something. I'm like, it can be really bad. With Zed, I have a safe lane versus everyone, and in mid late game, I can just go for any of the squeezes and do good.
Well, how is it in laning against Seraph? Because it's obviously a champion we haven't seen in the LCS before. So laning against him, what do you have to be careful about?
I was just trying to remember what was his passive all the time, because he was like signing when he auto attack. It's like he hit him mana back or something like that.
Yeah, it doesn't do too much against
him. No, it doesn't do much. I thought it was like extra damage or something. But it was pretty easy, kind of. Like, he doesn't put enough pressure. I haven't faced many Seraphs, so I was really scared at some point, but I think I could have pushed it even harder, because I can dodge his Q with my W really hard and put him super low, but I was just playing safe and farming and not taking any risks because I don't really know the champion that well.
You say you play safe, but then we saw you going back for the Brutalizer first item, so you were going quite aggressive. Did you guys know from early on in the game that it was going your way?
We felt like it until the Drake throw. There it felt a bit weird, but I still felt like we would win fights because our setup felt superior, kind of. It felt really strong. I know at some point I don't really have to one-shot the squeezes. I can one-shot Evelynn or Renekton or anyone. So even if he had Thonias and Lucian QSS, I was not too scared. And we as a team were playing still really good even after that mistake.
So now you guys have won 4 games in a row. You're actually tied for first place. No matter what happens in the Gambit SK game, you're still tied for first place. Why is Fnatic all of a sudden winning?
I have no idea. I really don't know. Like, I guess we go by, like, we win a lot of games, then we lose a lot of games, then we win a lot of games, and
there's nothing that feels different for you in the game. So you guys just doing the same things, now this just works? Or?
Yeah, it feels like we do the same, but it works. Like at some point when we were losing, we were knowing what we were losing. We were like, okay, we're doing this bad, we have to do it right, we have to focus on this because we always fail. And then we were trying to do it and we will fail at it, or we will do that right but fail at something else. And it just didn't work. And now it seems like everything works. Maybe everyone got their motivation back, their mood back, or their vision of the game. I don't know. Like everyone is doing the right movements, kind of.
Something that did came back, something you guys did a lot in Season 3, is running that teleport and you split pushing as well. Is that an active choice, or is that also just do what I feel like?
Do whatever. No, we think TP is really strong now. More with the, you can use it to go to lane and farm, and you only have 3 minutes cooldown. It's super strong. So we like it a lot more on top, because Ignite can give you a kill, but if you don't really get a kill, at some point TP is way more useful than Ignite. So we are trying it some games, yes, some games not. We are still not sure if it's super good, but we like it.
And I'd actually like to hear your opinion about Zed, because we saw it last game, now you played as well. Sorry, we saw it in the first game of the day, now you've been playing it. Why are we all of a sudden seeing Zed more now? What is it he brings?
The thing is, Zed is a really, really, really strong champion. You have to play him really, really good as well. And that's the problem. You have to play him every day a few games to keep the mechanics, and you have to know what to do. And it's our champion, but it's really good when you play him good. And when there are a lot of millionaires banned, and you know he's not going to pick Kayle, which is the only champ I really cannot play against, and I think every third is super hard to play versus Kayle, then you can pick him. He's super safe in lane and can one-shot anyone.
Yeah, Zed, with those shadows, you can play a lot of mind games, and that is actually also the question that we asked you guys on Twitter here earlier today. Which European LCS team plays the most mind games and why? And here are some of your answers. The first one is from @BrokenEmil. Rocket uses the most mind games. I mean, once a Mordekaiser, twice the Mordekaiser, and thrice the Lulu top. Everyone is scared of their next pick, but recently not so much.
Well, the thing is, when you plan your pick and ban phase against Rocket, you never know what they're going to bring up. You can all of a sudden feel like all your bans are useless because you just pick Mordekaiser and you're like, oh, we didn't expect it. So for me, the pick and ban phase for Rocket, at least in the earlier, in the start of the season, was very nice mind games.
The second tweet is from @TweetWishes. Alliance, their bad start to their season was only to make the other teams drop their guards. Do you feel like you're played by Alliance, Peke, now that you're tied with them for first place?
Maybe. We were talking about it last week, I think, after the games. And I were like, yeah, we were just giving them hope and like kind of joking, of course. And now we're all going to both go to the top. We'll meet there.
The last
one. He was just joking.
Just joking. Last one is from @WildJacobo. I think it might be Fnatic. The constant rotations, variable picks, and the classic Fnatic bushes keep them unpredictable.
Well, I think he should take it, of course. It's your team. So why are you guys playing mind games, and why are you so good at it?
I really have no idea. Like the mind games, we always play them, and they always seem to work out. When we're ahead, it's really easy. But when it comes to in the league, some games we play good, some games we play bad. We don't really know why is that. Like some games we know, okay, we play bad because we pick bad champions or bad team setup. But some games we lose them, and we are like, we just lose it. We don't know how it is.
Some very deep insight right there. Yeah. Thank you very much. And you guys, thanks at home for all those great answers. And remember, you can keep chatting about all of today's games by using that #LCS. Now, while the Rift is ready for our next match, we're going to take a short break. When we return, the Copenhagen Wolves and Rocket will clash. We'll be right back.